Penguin Audio presents The New York Stories by John O'Hara. Read by Becky Ann Baker, Dylan Baker, Bobby Cannavale, John Hamm, Richard Kind, Jan Maxwell, Gretchen Maul, and Dallas Roberts. With a foreword written and read by E.L. Doctorow.
This is E.L. Doctorow. Foreword. John O'Hara and the Short Story. John O'Hara was a newspaper man before he turned to fiction, and the seeming ease with which he wrote his stories and novels must have come of that facility given to reporters who write against a deadline. His output was prodigious, some 17 novels and hundreds of stories. In many instances, his prose has a repertorial tone. The presumptive reality in an O'Hara first sentence is almost insolent. He is a writer who has made it his business to know things and likes to tell you what he knows. O'Hara published his stories mostly in the New Yorker magazine, so they are usually characterized as New Yorker stories, as if that were a subspecies of the form. In fact, few of the pieces here dwell in that upper-middle-class suburban milieu that is popularly thought to define such fiction. It is more accurate to say that O'Hara practices the classic form of the modern short story, developed by Joyce and perfected by Hemingway. The entry point is close in time to the denouement, the setting is circumscribed, and the piece ideally yields some sort of revelation, or what Joyce called an epiphany. Writers today have mostly abandoned this tight form. Contemporary stories are more likely to have greater extension and to cover expanses of time and space that recall the pre-modernist tale of the 19th century. That O'Hara was an aggrieved writer who lived a tempestuous life is attested by the number of biographers he's had. Four at last count. Born in 1905, he grew up an Irish Catholic kid in the WASP town of Pottsville, Pennsylvania, where the caste system that only tolerated an O'Hara was to haunt him for the rest of his life. He had hoped to go to Yale, but the family's impoverishment after his father's death made that impossible. He never did attend college, turning instead to whatever jobs he could find as long as they weren't in Pottsville. He had learned reporting there on the local paper and migrated eventually to New York, where he worked for various papers and magazines, including the Herald Tribune and the Morning Telegraph and Time. But from his teenage years, O'Hara had been a drinker, and he was by his maturity a formidable alcoholic. This condition magnified an abrasive and truculent nature, presumably bred of his sense of himself as an irredeemable outsider. His life was in emotional shambles until he turned to the writing of fiction, and with his first novel, Appointment and Samara, a book that was widely praised and that launched him on his productive life, he found his true calling. Even so, whatever recognition he would receive in his long writing career, it would never be enough for him. His rage and resentment focused on the literary establishment's lack of regard for his achievement. He married three times, always up, and would settle in those communities, Quogue, Long Island, Princeton, New Jersey, that were an emblem of social success. But O'Hara aspired to a status that is ever beyond the reach of one so obsessed. There's a story about him that when, in 1964, he received the prestigious Award of Merit from the American Academy of Arts and Letters, he stood before that assembly speaking bitterly of the critical vilification he had all his life until that moment endured, and broke down weeping. None of this would matter to us as readers if, at the same time, John O'Hara's lifelong grievance had not provided him with a rigorous schooling in the class structures of American life. His sensitivity to class in America is the engine that drives his writing, his empowerment, and the issue that dominates his best stories. His authorial voice, almost always omniscient, can be reflective, ironic, compassionate, or amused, but no character he speaks of is without a manifestation of class. Distinctions are made between townies and summer people, between those who wear the little golden pig of Harvard's Porcelain Club and those who cannot dream of it, between the bank trustee and the bank manager, the Hollywood wise guy and the Westerner, between the aged and the young, between white and black, Protestant and Jew. But if he sometimes veers close to stereotype, he will surprise you with the complexity of a piece. The young man of family may be arrogant, snobbish, or simply stupidly complacent. The black butler in service to a house for a lifetime may be outspoken to the point of rudeness. The man of pedigree may be begging for a job. The snappish, wealthy woman may be in mourning for a dead son. O'Hara has a wide repertorial range. He is comfortable with characters at every level of society. Barkeepers, showgirls, wealthy widows, family doctors, cops, lovesick boys, nightclubbing drunks, federal officials, small-town school board members. His coverage is worthy of a Balzac. He knows that a description of physical appearance is incidental to effective characterization. His people are made from their positions in life, their relationship to one another, their clothes, their values, but above all, from the way they talk. O'Hara's remarkable ear for American speech serves him time and again for his renderings. Thus, an elevator operator will say he usedn't to stop at a certain floor. A secretary boarding a bus says to a flirtatious bus driver, "I have a good notion to report you, the nerve." A university clubman speaking to an outsider says, "I don't know why fellows like you never would have made it in 1,000 years. But I've said exactly the wrong thing, haven't I?" A chorus girl named Reba Gold is displeased with her married lover, Seymour Harrisburg, who is importuning her. "Take your hands off me," she says. "I and you are all washed up." Oh, that's from the story of the public career of Mr. Seymour Harrisburg, one of two or three in the collection that show O'Hara was not without prejudices of his own. He was of the same generation as Hemingway and T.S. Eliot that found anti-Semitic expression useful in their work. In this case, the authorial tone is one of derisive amusement. The copyright notices indicate that some of the stories here were first published between 1933 and 1947. In those years, having barely emerged from the disastrous social experiment of Prohibition, America suffered the Great Depression and then went to war. None of these monumental events are given direct mention. We know of World War II only as a woman mourns her son, or someone speaks of gas rationing, or a young naval officer dreams of the civilian life he would lead someday. One can wonder about this, how a writer, who is as much of a photographic portraitist as O'Hara, could so constrict his focus. No rumrunners here, no Okies fleeing the dust storms, no workers on strike, no soup lines, no soldiers leaping from their landing craft or storming the redoubts of Iwo Jima. Criticizing a writer for what he has not written is something that may be useful during the writer's lifetime, as questions about what literature should do, should be, are argued and re-argued, and writers can come to define themselves of fine realization, as perhaps they would not were there no critical clashing of swords. But when the writer is no longer alive, such criticism may only be useful as a means of identifying the nature of his achievement. As readers, we take what we can get. Perhaps it is relevant to note that O'Hara worshipped Ernest Hemingway and clearly understood the key to that master's short fiction. When composing a story, withhold the essential information. Do not mention whatever it is that causes the characters to act as they do. O'Hara understood how such restraint is a means of fictive power, and he works this way in the gems of this collection. Read A Phase of Life. A man and woman in an apartment talk idly of a past in show business that was clearly a better time in their lives. When the doorbell rings, the man picks up a poker from the fireplace and goes to the door. But the arrivals turn out to be people he knows. He serves them drinks. He brings out a projector and shows them a movie. Everyone except the man retires to the bedrooms, and when a while later the guests emerge, they pay up and leave. The larger social condition underlying the story is left for the reader to infer. And wasn't it Anton Chekhov who advised a young writer not to describe the moon shining, but to show in a fragment of glass a glint of moonlight? E.L. Doctorow.
Agatha. Both dogs had been out, She could tell by the languid way they greeted her and by the fact that Jimmy, the elevator operator, had taken his 25-cent piece off the hall table. Or was it Jimmy? Yes, Jimmy was on mornings this week. Ray was on afternoons and evenings. Jimmy liked dogs. Ray did not. The day was off to a better start when Jimmy took the dogs for their morning walk. It was nicer to start the day with the thought that Jimmy, who liked dogs, had exercised them.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.